this church.
Worship today.
Morning.
I'd like to welcome any guests and visitors that we may have here today and invite you downstairs after worship for coffee and fellowship. And as you can see, Pastor Denise is away today. This is part of, she gets a week sabbatical every month. And so we have Father Larry today filling in for Denise. So, I'm sure he will do a great job for us. So, let's start off with our joys and concerns. Pat?
Yes, I'd like prayers for our family. My niece, Michelle,
here
passed away unexpectedly yesterday.
Okay, so prayers for the Capture family, and it was Jill? Oh, the fairy that passed away this week. Any other prayer concerns or joys? I'm going to offer up my oldest son, Dan's mother-in-law, Myra Orbach. She's diabetic, and she had to have her toes removed on her right foot. So this just happened like 2 days ago, you know. Heck of a way to spend the holidays up in St. Francis Hospital. So prayers for her and my son Dan, he's still going through some things, and we're hoping that possibly part of his problems are related to a hyperthyroid. So he has a upcoming doctor's appointment, because he's losing a lot of weight. And talking to Larry about his conditions, it seemed quite similar to what his wife had gone through. So hopefully this can be diagnosed properly, and hopefully he'll get things cleared up. So, any other joys or concerns? All right, moving on to announcements. Melissa?
I know it says it in the bulletin, but the Dinner Church Christmas party is this Wednesday, January 3rd. And then Deacons is January 4th.
Right.
And then Epiphany is, and Star Gift Sunday is next Sunday. So we can get our star gifts, guys.
There isn't any sign up for the Christmas party, dinner church at all?
Not that I'm aware of, okay. Not that I was told.
Wednesday night. Dinner church. Okay. Okay. Any other announcement?
Yeah, I do want to announce that our thank you all for the generous collection we got for Denise. I tried to present it Christmas Eve, but it didn't fit in without me interrupting the service too much. But I did give her a card expressing our thanks and giving her that generous donation. So thank you, everybody.
Okay. Thank you, Larry. Any other announcements? Barry?
Yeah, I've been in contact with the counseling service that's going to be renting the old Sunday school rooms. And she's had some delays. Her son's been sick. But she hopes to come in this week and start planning, sorting through, and how she'll be setting up.
Okay. All right, so counseling service renting the upper part of the Stoughton building, hopefully starting soon. Any other announcements? All right, let us begin with our opening hymn, number 181, As With Gladness Men of Old. Whether we're leaving behind a year of joy and blessing or trials and difficulties, we pause to give thanks. We thank you that you are always with us every single day of every single year. Please remind us of your presence in the year ahead, even when life is busy. We are so thankful that we serve a God who makes things new and gives us the grace of fresh starts and new beginnings. Be glorified in our lives this year. In Jesus' name, amen. Let us continue in silent prayer. Gracious Lord, please be with all of those who we have lifted up this morning. Let them feel your presence in their lives. Please comfort them and ease their pain or despair. Offer them hope and guidance to a better future. We ask all of these things in your name, our Lord, our Savior. Amen. Now let us say the prayer that our Lord and Savior has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom.
Thank you.
Please be seated. You can follow along with the scripture reading. 6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter, James, and his brother John, and led them up a high mountain by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became dazzling white. Suddenly there appeared to be with them Moses and Elijah talking with them. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Lord, it is good for us to be here. If you wish, I will make dwellings here, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." While he was still speaking, suddenly a bright cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud a voice said, "This is my son, the beloved. With him I am well pleased. Listen to him." When the disciples heard this, they fell to the ground and were overcome by fear. But Jesus came and touched them, saying, "Get up and do not be afraid." And when they looked up, they saw no one except Jesus himself alone. Now, instead of the lectionary, which today should have been about Jesus being consecrated at 8 days old, and how Simeon and Anna had foretold the great person and the change in the world. But instead, I'm going to talk a little about my faith journey. Some of you bear with me because some of you heard it before, and I want to talk about mountaintop experiences and how they can affect your faith. You know, over the years, there have been many strong, faithful people that I've looked up to, respected, and never felt I came close to. I'm going to mention two or three of those. First of all, I went through Sunday school here, went through my teenage years and into my early 20s. A Sunday school teacher I had, who was my first person I really looked up to, was Ralph Johnson. And some of you may know Ralph had a fall and was paralyzed from the waist down. He managed to drive a car with hand controls. He managed to get in and out of his car. He taught Sunday school, was very active in this church. And despite all those issues, he was one of the most faithful person I ever knew. But back to attending church, I got married in my late 20s, moved to Hartford, married a Catholic woman, and we went to her church sometimes, but I rarely went to church for 2 years because she was not that strong a Catholic. Then I moved to Hartford for 26 years. I went to the Congregational Church on Federal Hill sometimes. I came here sometimes, but pretty much I would say that I drifted away for 26 years. Then I built, 20 years or so ago, next to my mother's, where my mother was living, and she was driving to church. And I don't know why, but I decided to start bringing her to church and driving her, and I've been here ever since. But when I came back here, I had been away so long, I didn't know Claudia Weber very well, but she was very active apparently and was a Sunday school teacher. But most of the time I knew Claudia, she was in a wheelchair. Always upbeat though, always reading religious books, coming to Bible study, and such a faithful person. So very much like Ralph, with all her troubles, she was so faithful. And then, of course, the third person I'll talk about is my sister, Carol. And if you know from our funeral service, she suffered with pain her whole life. But she was always caring. She was always smiling, and she always lived her faith. So I guess I'd say all these people had one thing in common. They all had terrible challenges in life, and yet they were faithful people. So now I want to switch to mountaintop experiences a minute.
Now, what are these? They are defined as moments of significant revelations given by God, or a time feeling especially close to God, maybe seeing Jesus as never before. I'm going to read that again. Moments of significant revelations given by God, or a time feeling especially close to God, or maybe seeing Jesus as never before. And of course, the best example of all is the scripture we just read, where Peter, James, and John saw something they were scared of. They saw Elijah, Moses, and Jesus, as the scripture says, and this is, by the way, in two other scriptures in the Bible. And yet, when they looked up, like it says in line 11, Elijah and Moses were gone, but Jesus was still there. And Jesus tells them later in the scripture, do not repeat any of what you've seen until the time is gone that I leave this earth. So, I'm going to tell you about a couple mountaintop experiences I've heard. Lorraine, my sister Lorraine, has two, and I'm going to share one of them. Lorraine was dealing with being a widow at a young age with five children. And it was difficult, but she did extremely well, I thought. I didn't know how she did it, but she did well. And the family was there, I think, for Lorraine, plus raising the kids. But there were times that we didn't know that Lorraine was extremely lonely. So there was one such time when she would pray and walk through the woods and kind of try to speak to Lee and would pray to God. And she felt very alone, and she expressed that to God. And she said, "I don't know if I have these words right, but why have you left me alone?" There was a light snow cover, and Lorraine looked down and saw footprints, much like the story of footprints in the sand that you've heard, and she swears she saw footprints. There were no footprints in front of that, nor behind it. And that changed Lorraine. She didn't feel alone. What was my place in finding out the other one? I wasn't going to tell this one because I didn't want this to get too long, but I think I will tell it about John that I worked with at Connecticut Spring. John was a toolmaker, made a lot of money. One of the nicest guys I ever knew, but I knew nothing about him, his faith, or anything. And one day I was walking out in the shop at lunch hour, people would play cards or they would do crossword puzzles, and I saw a bunch of people around John. And so I asked him later, "Why, it takes that many people to do a crossword puzzle, John?" He said, "No, we're studying the Bible." And John explained to me, he said, "When I was 19 years old, I was a wild, I messed with women, I drank a lot, I drag raced cars, and I wasn't a good person. My parents didn't know what to do with me. One cloudy day, at 19, I'm riding to my part-time job. On a cloudy day, he said, I turned a corner, and there was a bright light, a sun, and I had to pull over. And he said, I don't know what happened, but I converted to Jesus. So, I wonder if some of you have had any of these uplifting spiritual experiences, because I never talked to any of you about them. Maybe you have. I wish I could say I had. But the more I thought about this, the more I realized we're not all going to have dramatic mountaintop experiences. I asked Tom the other day, and we're coming back from indoor golf, he got me to already, and we're coming back, and I asked him, and he said, "No, I can't really say like I've heard words or seen something written in the sky or anything like that." But he said, you know, I was at a gravesite service for a teacher friend that had passed away. And he said, something that I never felt before washed over me at that gravesite. So who's to know? And little things. How about Doug after Carol's service, when I asked how he wrote such beautiful words, telling me I didn't write those words, Jesus wrote those words. And then I thought about how we feel when we see a beautiful sunset, or a rainbow, or the peace when we see rolling waves, or any windows, or Barry can experience being at the top of a ski mountain, the feeling you have before you go down. Now, I thought that I had never had anything close to mountaintop experience. Then I realized I had one, maybe not as significant, but when I was on a retreat, they did a communion service, and the minister was very graphic, and he described the crucifixion of Jesus, and we were all weeping, and we felt it. So maybe. All right, so I'm going to say I don't do well reading the Bible at home. I rarely do. I often find my mind wandering when I'm in prayer. When they say trust and give yourself complete to the Lord, I can't say I do real well at that. But then thinking about worship and church, you know, I realize we're not all going to have inspiring, dramatic services every week. Sometimes the sermon will really sink in, sometimes the music will really affect us, and sometimes not. But then again, there are going to be services like the greeting of the church, or there's going to be a Maundy Thursday service, or a Christmas Eve service, where I think we do feel more connected. So anyway, I guess I realize it's not just me. I think we all desire a closer relationship with God. So I think looking up to the many faithful from the past and those for today is good for us. They're examples to follow, and they inspire us. So being here, sharing scripture, singing, praying together, worshiping together, this is where we need to be. This is part of our journey. Let us pray. Lord, after the uplifting season of Lent and celebration of the birth of your Son, Christ, help us keep our spirits up going into the new year. Guide us in continuing worship and our desire for a closer walk with you. Now I'm going to do something a little unorthodox here, and I hope it works. Before we play before we sing the final hymn, and I'll tell you when we do this, I'm going to be playing a TV interview with Chris Christopherson, who wrote this "Why Me, Lord" song, and I'll let him sing through one verse, and then Marilyn will play the first verse, and then we'll sing it. So let's see if this works.
something to me like, are you ready to accept Jesus Christ in your life or something? And I said, I don't know. I didn't know what I was doing there. And he put me down. He said, kneel down there. And he, I can't even remember what he was saying, but whatever it was such a release for me that I found myself weeping in public. I felt this forgiveness that I didn't know I even needed.
Could we get you and Janie, Frankie, and Willie to do this?
Sing harmony. Amen.
Well, we'll try. I'll do it in G, and I hope I don't mess up the beat.
Okay, Marilyn will play this the first time through, and then we'll stand and sing this song that's in your insert in the bulletin.
And just so you know, I'm just going to play the notes. I'm not going to play the accompaniment like what you usually hear with a hymn, so that it might be easier for you to find the notes if you just have to follow along with one. Are, so
okay.
It's hard to keep track. What did you just sing.
The next line is triangular.
Think there's a way?
Yeah, we're up to triangular.
You're up to here?
Yes.
Okay, all right. Here we go.
Love of God go with us this day and forevermore. Amen.